Today on Top Shelf Sports, it's almost conference tournament time. We'll update you on where the Huskies sit in the standings.
This week's leader of the pack made a comeback look easy. We'll show you how.
And it's been a real special season for the gymnastics team. Find out how they honor some of their stars. Top Shelf Sports starts now. Hello and welcome to the newest edition of Top Shelf Sports. I'm Kobe Price.
And I'm Jamia Green. Kobe, this has been a pretty busy week for our Huskies.
It absolutely was, and we have a ton to get through, so I'm going to start us off on the hardwood. Men's basketball is looking to host the opening round of the MAC tournament for the first time since 2016. The Huskies are currently the number 8 seed in the MAC standings with a 7-10 conference record after defeating the Central Michigan Chippewas 89-86 Tuesday. Levi Bradley scored a game-high 26 points in the victory, while Lacey James recorded a monstrous double-double with 16 points and 19 rebounds. NIU will face off against the Ball State Cardinals tonight at 6 p.m. If the Huskies win, they'll host the first round of the playoffs Monday in the Convocation Center. A loss will put NIU on the road to start the postseason tournament.
Women's basketball fell in their last home game of the season on Wednesday against Ball State University, 67-64. Senior guard Michaela Voigt was honored in her senior night and put up 30 points, but it wasn't enough to overcome the Cardinals. The Huskies trailed 22-9 after the first quarter, but battled back to make the game interesting. Ball State hit a three with just 1.9 seconds left on the clock, and the last effort by the Huskies came up just short. NIU will close out their regular season on the road tomorrow at Western Michigan at 1 p.m. The Huskies may be coming off a loss, but that isn't stopping a certain athlete from staying focused. Top Shelf sports reporter Martin Sotelo has more on how toughness and determination truly pays off.
Junior women's basketball player Maya Starks brings a lot of excitement on the court. Her ability to blow by defenders with a sweet crossover dribble is nothing short of impressive. As the point guard of the team, Starks is constantly in command of the offense, but what really separates Maya is her ability to play defense, and that's something she doesn't take lightly.
I know that if I play really good defense and I'm aggressive, that my defense turns into offense, so I just try to get after it on defense and use my strength.
And Maya definitely brings passion to both ends of the court. She's currently third in the team in scoring, averaging just over 11.5 points per game to go along with her solid on-ball defense. But what's really remarkable has been her road to recovery. Stark suffered a season-ending injury last year after tearing her ACL on January 6th against the University of Buffalo. But through her hard work and dedication, Maya returned to the court and just in time for the team's season opener against Yale. And after making a full recovery in as little as 10 months, head coach Lisa Carlson believes that confidence is something that she has always had.
I don't think there was any doubt in her mind that she was going to come back as good or better than she was before. You could see it in her rehab. She was diligent on a day-to-day basis, really made sure she was doing what she needed to get back to where she was.
Regardless of how well Starks plays, she always makes sure to show support for her teammates. And while she may only be listed at 5'4" tall, that doesn't stop Maya from reaching her goals.
Being small doesn't stop me from doing anything. I know that I'm more than capable of playing on this level and being able to produce. So honestly, it doesn't really matter what size you are, you can still compete.
Maya's all-around game, toughness, and ability to play big leave her as this week's leader of the pack. For Top Shelf Sports, I'm Martin Sotelo.
The baseball team was swept this past weekend against the Kansas Jayhawks, extending the team's losing streak to 5 games. Junior Nate Thomas ended the weekend with his perfect ERA intact, having given up only one hit so far this season in 4 appearances. The Huskies now sit at 2-9. They played their first of 8 games over 10 days starting today at 3 p.m. against Southern Illinois.
NIU softball is back in action. The Huskies start a stretch of their season when they play 12 games in 10 days. The Huskies started off that stretch at the Husky Classic with Idaho State before facing the host and 2018 national runner-up Washington at 8 p.m. NIU head coach Christina Sutcliffe believes that this tournament is a great opportunity for the Huskies to compete at a national level. The first pitch is set for 3:30 p.m. at Mary M. Bell Field.
The gymnastics team won their final regular season home meet last week against the ISU Redbirds. Starting on the vault, junior Cindy Lamberti came in first with a score of 9.850, tying with the Redbirds. The Huskies struggled on the bars, finishing with a 48.450 score, just under the Redbirds of 47.950. On the beam, the Huskies came out on top. Freshman Mia Lord won the event with a score of 9.90, helping the Huskies reach their third highest overall beam score since 2006 with a 49.175. On the floor, the Huskies won 49.050 to 48.625. Good luck to the girls this weekend and their tri meet in Champaign tomorrow at 2 p.m. Four seniors were honored in the gymnastics meet last Friday. Among the seniors honored was Anna Martucci, Emily Becerra, Paige Nicholas, and Allie Ferber. The girls have contributed a lot to the team, and our reporter Maddie Barrett got an inside look into the four seniors and their legacies.
Four seniors from the NIU gymnastics team are graduating this May, and they have contributed a lot to the team along with making plenty of memories. With the current team record of 11-4, they have helped the program achieve a lot of success. With so many strong performances throughout the season, Paige Nicholas reminisces about her favorite meet.
I would say that at Ball State this year, when I got my career high, it was just awesome, like, feeling like I just did the best routine I could do, and then looking out and seeing all those girls so excited, got a hug from every single one of them, and coaches too.
Having constant success during meets is something that these gymnasts are accustomed to, but things didn't always go as planned. Emily Becerra suffered a major injury as a freshman after tearing her ACL and part of her meniscus. But with hard work and dedication, she managed to come back stronger than ever. And after several years since the injury, she reflects on her experience.
Looking back on it, like, I don't even remember, like, hurting myself. Like, I feel like I've just come so far as a gymnast. I've really kind of developed this new mindset, this new skill set for each and every event.
The team recently hosted Illinois State on senior night, where they managed to pull off an impressive victory. The ladies didn't start off the way they wanted to, but with leadership from the seniors, they managed to push through. And while they may have come out on top, it didn't come without adversity.
I love the passion and grit that they have. I mean, this past weekend's meet was the best example of that, with Emily literally hitting her face in the bar and pushing through her routine and not only finishing it, but sticking the dismount for all of us and then getting off the mat to apologize. And I think a lot of girls would, in that circumstance, do the same thing.
This is the end of the road for these four seniors. And as the years have gone by, Allie Ferber explains what makes them so unique.
Having a second family that's so far from home, I know I can count on any of these girls for anything. And being able to share a passion for a sport with them, that's been awesome.
The girls will compete in a couple of meets before returning home on March 23rd for the MAC Championships. And while the end may be near, they plan on leaving a lasting impression that will stay with Husky Nation forever. For Top Shelf Sports, I'm Maddie Barrett.
After the break, some NFL scouts were on campus to check out some of NIU's finest. We'll give you the latest.
And NIU Wrestling has some new competition to look forward to. Find out which teams are added to the MAC. We'll be right back.
You made this vacation happen, cleverly merging promotions,
double points with every purchase,
and cross-referencing travel sites. Aloha! If you can ace your vacation, you can do it for retirement. Get on track with tips at aceyourretirement.org.
Listen, I realize that I'm not perfect, but it all really started to change because you judge me for having a problem. No one is going to know that I need help. I need help. I know that no one is going to judge me for having a problem. I realize that I'm not perfect, but it all really started to change because you listen.
This past week has been huge for NFL draft prospects, including several from NIU.
Topsail sports reporter James Krause has the news from Pro Day in DeKalb.
Wednesday at the Chesapeake Practice Center wasn't just another football practice, it was a large-scale job interview. NIU Pro Day gave 18 former Husky football players their opportunity to showcase their abilities in front of scouts from 20 NFL teams. Players got the chance to talk with scouts one-on-one, as well as measure their strength, speed, and athleticism in a variety of drills. Defensive end Sutton Smith and offensive lineman Max Sharping both appeared in front of scouts this past weekend at the NFL Combine in Indianapolis. Sharping told the media Wednesday that he appreciated the once-in-a-lifetime opportunity.
I did, yeah, it was a good experience. Not everyone gets to go through that, so it was pretty cool to be able to be there. And then with Sutton there, I got to see him a little bit, give him some advice because I went first. So it was pretty cool for both of us, I think.
Smith was among those in attendance Wednesday but did not participate in any drills due to a nagging ankle injury. Smith, however, says despite it, he's confident in his combine workouts.
Like I said, I couldn't have felt better about my performance at the combine. There's a lot of people saying that I put out a clinic tape for linebacker drills and stuff like that, and I've never played linebacker, so that ups my spirits with it, and I know that the next step is going to be life-changing for me, so just can't wait.
Sharping, meanwhile, limited his practice Wednesday to position drills only, saying his focus is getting back into football condition ahead of the draft.
Just trying to get back into football shape. I was training for all this underwear Olympic stuff. I'm not really a track athlete, you know, at 320 pounds. So just trying to get back in more football shape and how I can prepare for camp right after the draft.
For players like wide receiver DJ Brown who weren't invited to the combine, Pro Day is a valuable way to get time and practice in front of scouts who have only seen them on film.
Oh, it was big. Because you put on a film and they all think, okay, these are your best plays. We want to see you in person. We want to see how big you are in person, how you run routes in person. Definitely feel confident. We just see where the chips fall.
The prospects now have to play the waiting game, with the NFL draft starting April 27th. Those who aren't selected then still have a chance to join a team as an undrafted free agent and be a part of rookie camps in May. For Top Shelf Sports, I'm James Krause.
The wrestling team is in action today in Norfolk, Virginia for the MAC Championships. The Huskies entered the competition in the sixth seed. Keep an eye on redshirt freshman Britt Wilson. He has been solid all year long and made the climb to the 13th best in the coaches' polls at 174 pounds. The MAC also announced some historic additions to their wrestling program earlier this week. The MAC added 7 new programs to the conference: Bloomsburg, Clarion, Edinburgh, Lock Haven, Ryder, George Mason, and Cleveland State all now reside in the conference. These additions make the MAC the second biggest wrestling conference in the NCAA.
The men's tennis team will spend their spring break in Orlando, Florida. Lucky them. After a 5-2 win against Green Bay, the Huskies take a trip to the Sunshine State. With a pair of matches ahead of them, the Huskies face Valparaiso Saturday and Youngstown State on Sunday. This is the final 2 non-conference contests for the Huskies before opening MAC play. The first serve is set for 11 a.m. Saturday.
Switching over to the women's team, the Huskies were edged by SIU at Edwardsville Sunday. After losing double points, the Huskies split single matches. The ladies are currently in action at the Rockford Tennis Center taking on the UIC Flames. First serve was at 11 a.m.
This was a pretty significant week for football fans, with top prospects competing in the NFL Combine.
And March Madness is right around the corner. Top Shelf sports reporter Emily LaRusso has more in this week's Campus Corner.
Thanks, Kobe and Jamia. It's been an exciting week, so let's get it started on the football field. The NFL Combine had many talented players this year, but one of the standouts is Ole Miss defensive back Zedrick Woods. Woods had an impressive 4.29 40-yard dash, making that run the fastest 40 time in this year's NFL Combine. The 3-year starter for the Rebels, Woods recorded 79 tackles, 2 interceptions, and 2 forced fumbles this past year as a senior. As of now, the top NFL draft prospect is none other than Oklahoma Sooners quarterback and Heisman Trophy winner Kyler Murray. Murray also signed with the Oakland A's organization, but recently turned down the MLB to pursue his football career. Murray didn't participate in the NFL combine drills, but he will be fully active in Oklahoma's Pro Day on March 13th. Duke and North Carolina face off for the second time this season on Saturday. This is both teams' last game of the regular season. The first time the teams played, North Carolina took the W, 88-72. Duke star Zion Williamson is still questionable from the February 20th matchup of the two rivals when he broke through his shoe, injuring his knee. This will be a crucial game for the upcoming ACC tournament. An assistant TCU football coach is involved in an FBI bribery case involving Adidas and several NCAA men's basketball teams. The case also includes Christian Dawkins, who previously worked at a sports agency. According to an indictment, Dawkins allegedly met with the TCU assistant in July 2017 and gave him $6,000 to steer his players to hire Dawkins' services once they declared for the draft. The TCU coach has not yet been charged. This weekend in college basketball holds critical matchup leading up to the championship week. A couple big games include Duke versus UNC in the ACC and Kansas State versus Oklahoma in the Big 12 Conference. Both of these teams will tip off tomorrow at 5 p.m. In East Lansing, Big Ten competitors and in-state rivals Michigan State and the University of Michigan will play also at 5 p.m. So if you're a college basketball fan, this is going to be an exciting weekend for you. Well, that's all I have for you guys today. Back to you at the desk.
When we come back, remember how to win games. We'll update you on their latest wild finish.
And we got a jam-packed top five plays that you won't want to miss. Stay with us.
You know, Jamia, it's still really cold outside, but spring training is right around the corner, to give us some baseball to look forward to.
You're right. And I hear the Bulls tank isn't going as planned. Let's send it over to Isai Sanchez to update us on Chicagoland sports.
Thanks, guys. With spring getting closer, there is a lot more happening in Chicago sports. So let's get started. We begin with a possible roster change for the Chicago Bears. According to ESPN's Adam Schefter, the Bears were approached by several teams during the combine for a potential trade for running back Jordan Howard. This news comes after Howard saw his role reduced last season in first-year head coach Matt Nagy's offense. Howard was drafted by the Bears in the fifth round of the 2016 draft. Now, let's talk about the other football, you know, soccer. The MLS season kicked off last weekend and Chicago Fire unfortunately didn't start off on the right foot in a showdown against LA Galaxy. So both teams were struggling to get things going in the first half, but all of that changed when Galaxy defender Diego Polenta made a bad pass, and Fire made sure to take advantage, scoring the first goal of the day. But their lead was short-lived because in the 68th minute, LA Galaxy would keep their hopes alive, tying the game. And 20 minutes later, a killer header from Zlatan Ibrahimovic would see Chicago lose their first game of the season. The team will look to bounce back in their home opener this Saturday. So how are the Bulls doing, you ask? Well, let me tell you. Wednesday's game was interesting. We start in the fourth quarter with less than a minute to go. Zach LaVine scores the game, tying points, but the drama wouldn't end there. With less than 5 seconds left, Jimmy Butler gets fouled and will give the 76ers a one-point lead. But LaVine would respond with a go-ahead layup to give the Bulls the lead once again. And so this is where things get interesting, because the Sixers have the ball and they're trying to score, but the clock runs out and the game is over, right? It's over. Or is it? Because after review, the referees determined that no one actually touched the ball when the horn went off, so the game was still not over, I guess? So the players had to come back onto the court, and the 76ers, they still had some shots, right? Nah, they still lost. The Bulls will look to keep this magic going tonight against the Pistons. And it may not look like it outside, but believe it or not, we're already in preseason baseball. So let's start with the Cubs. They started off hot, scoring 3 runs early, but the Colorado Rockies answered back with their own 3 runs in both the 3rd and 6th inning. So the Cubs would end up losing 7-5. And as for the White Sox, well, they got themselves a win Thursday against the Milwaukee Brewers. But the Sox got things going on a little late in the game. But when they got going, they got going. You know, they scored eight runs in 3 innings. And at the end of the day, the White Sox win 9-5. And finally, the Blackhawks looked to break their 2-game losing streak when they faced off against Buffalo. So this match went back and forth, which sent it into overtime. Who doesn't love a little bit of overtime? Unfortunately, or fortunately, depending on whether you wanted some more hockey action Thursday night, the teams were still tied, so this game went to shootouts. And this is where the Blackhawks sealed the deal and got themselves another win, keeping their playoff hopes alive. The Hawks will look to keep this going in a showdown against Dallas this Saturday. Hopefully that's enough Chicago sports for you, because that's all I have for now. So now let's send it over to our fantasy whiz, Martin Sotelo, who has all the insight you need for your fantasy basketball team.
Well, thanks, Isai. You're truly kind. Well, hello, Husky Nation, and welcome to this week's fantasy update. Now, I wouldn't consider myself a fantasy whiz, but for the playoffs, you know, just about to start, here's some sleepers that can help your team get that much-needed victory. For my first player, we're going to take a look down Broadway with Knicks center Mitchell Robinson. The big man has been rock solid all season long, grabbing rebounds, blocking shots, catching alley-oop dunks. He has been a top 10 center in ESPN leagues over the past 2 weeks, and honestly, I don't see him slowing down anytime soon. So go ahead and scoop him up. You won't be disappointed. Moving over to my next pick, we're actually going to return to the Big Apple and look at Joe Harris from the Brooklyn Nets. This sharpshooter does a great job of knocking down threes while also making plays for his teammates. He's averaging just under 14 points per game and can also score off the dribble. And to top it off, Harris has also won this year's three-point contest, beating the likes of Steph Curry and Buddy Hield. So I think you should be able to bank on his production. And for my next player, we're going to keep the Nets theme going with point guard Spencer Dinwiddie. Dinwiddie recently missed a few weeks, but with a thumb injury, and he's back and playing better than ever. This point guard is coming off an impressive 28 performance where he absolutely took apart the Cleveland Cavaliers. And with the team facing the Atlanta Hawks tomorrow, he's in line for another big performance. Now for my next player, we're going to look at another big man who has been extremely productive for the Atlanta Hawks. And no, it's not Alex Len. I'm talking about none other than Dwayne Dedmon. Now this center has been on an absolute tear since taking over starting duties earlier this season. He's averaging just under 14 points to go along with 10 rebounds over his last 10 games. And to make things better, he's owning just under 20% of ESPN leagues. So what are you waiting for? Go get him. And for my final player of the week, I think I'm going to go with Thomas Satoransky from the Washington Wizards. The team may be struggling this season, but that hasn't stopped this point guard from getting buckets. Satoransky has played at least 35 minutes over the past 7 games, and boy has he made the most of it. He has averaged over 20 fantasy points during his impressive run and is owning just 30% of ESPN leagues, so pick him up and don't look back. That's all I have for you in this week's fantasy update. Hopefully my picks will help make your team a successful playoff run. Back to you, Kobe and Jamia.
Kobe.
Jamia.
It's time for our favorite segment, the top 5 plays of the week.
Now, you know I'm always super duper excited for top 5 plays, so I'll get us started. Coming in at number five, we take you to the National Lacrosse League, where Stephen LeBlanc of the New England Black Wolves just surprises the goalie here.
He surprised me too. I didn't even see it.
Kids, now let this be a lesson to eat your carrots so you have the vision to stop goals like these.
At number four, Marcos Molina of the Mets thinks he has a hit, but St. Louis Cardinals Harrison Bardis makes a spectacular diving catch to make the out.
Ooh, Jamia, I felt that dive in my stomach.
Yeah, me too. Cardinals lost this one, unfortunately, 10-8.
At number three, Chicago's new favorite son, Ryan Arcidiacono, dives into the stands to the delight of Jim Boylan before Otto Porter Jr. throws a very aesthetically pleasing lob.
They need to put that man back in the dunk contest.
Man, Zach LaVine deserves it too. Bulls won this one 108-107.
At number two, we have a goal from Lester Schuner to give Ajax a 4-1 lead over Real Madrid in the Champions League round of 16.
Let's take one more look at it. Whoo! Such precision on that one.
Ajax picked up the win to advance.
And at number one for our top play of the week, Miles Turner catches a body when he slams it over Jonathan Isaac.
There's a big man in town.
He got that right. Him with a mean mug too. Ooh, flex on him. Orlando wins this one 117-112. Now, I'm not sure if you heard, Jamia, but Miles Turner is my center for my NBA 2K Fantasy League, so I'm kind of used to those kind of plays happening.
Can you dunk like that, though? You know, your Kobe mini Mamba.
I'd rather not get into that right now.
Alrighty then. Top Shelf Sports is written and produced by students here at Northern Illinois University.
To keep up with everything Husky Athletics, make sure to check out our social media. I'm Corey Price.
And I'm Jamia Green. Before we go, we want to thank the students and teachers who joined us today from Sycamore Middle School. It was awesome having you here.
Until next time, Husky Nation.